Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Blue Tattoo, The Life of Olive Oatman, by Margot Mifflin, narrated by Kaipo Schwab. Prologue. Emigrant Song. Within our newly acquired possessions on the borders of Mexico and the Pacific Coast, and the recently organized territories in the interior of the continent, are numerous powerful and warlike tribes, of whom little is known, and whose history has no connection with that of the people of the United States, except the fact that they were original occupants of the soil, and that some of them, especially the California Indians, yet dispute our right to sovereignty. In the early 1850s, Olive Oatman was a typical pioneer girl heading west on a wagon train full of Mormons in search of gold and God. By the end of the decade, she was a white Indian with a chin tattoo, torn between two cultures. Orphaned at 14 after her family was massacred by Yavapai Indians in northern Mexico, now southern Arizona, Oatman spent a year as a slave to her attackers before she was traded to the Mohaves, who tattooed her and raised her as their own. 4 years later, under threat of war, the Mohaves delivered her back to the whites in exchange for horses, blankets, and beads. This much is true, but the fine points of Oatman's transformation from 49er to white savage have been replayed in countless books and articles, modern and Victorian, that read like Rashomons of revisionist history and romantic conjecture. In her day, Oatman was freakish enough to invite speculation and guarded enough to ensure that the speculation never ended. Because her story was saturated with violence, military intrigue, and sexual innuendo, it quickly became legend. She was the subject of a lurid, best-selling biography published in 1857 called Life Among the Indians by a Methodist reverend named Royal B. Stratton, who stripped her Mormonism from her narrative and portrayed the caring Mohave Indians who raised her as degraded bipeds. Stratton also launched Oatman's nearly decade-long public speaking career. Her experience inspired plays, artworks, and in the 1880s, theft, when the first tattooed circus ladies used it as a script for their own Wild West fabrications about being taken captive and tattooed by redskins. Today, in the Arizona town that bears her name, her cheerless, tattooed face adorns the Olive Oatman restaurant, across the street from the Oatman Hotel, where, in its better days, Clark Gable and Carol Lombard spent their honeymoon. In 1943, the Galveston Daily News claimed that a group of Southwest scholars had voted the Oatman saga Americans' favorite Indian story of the West. It is still told constantly around campfires, in college lectures, even on radio programs, the paper asserted. Perhaps a bit too promotionally, because this was the reason for telling it again, incorrectly. Because the Mohaves have no written language, their impressions of Oatman's captivity were not recorded during her lifetime. But in the mid-20th century, anthropologist A. L. Krober published an interview he had conducted in 1903 with a Mohave who had known her that contradicted what Stratton had written about her allegedly shabby treatment by the tribe, as did Krober's publication of Oatman's first post-ransom interview with the military commander Martin Burke, who retrieved her. What Oatman told Burke, as well as the first journalist to interview her after her ransom, differed markedly from the Stratton account and raised questions about whether she ever wanted to leave the Mojaves in the first place. Today, any Mojave who knows her story will say the tribe saved her life. "They felt sorry for her," said Llewellyn Barackman, a tribal elder and spokesperson who died in 2006. "We have a feeling for people." What is merely a historical footnote for the Mojaves has become a lovingly burnished, ever-evolving myth for white Americans. 150 years after Oatman's return, writers, amateur and professional, religious and scholarly, continue to rework it, invariably reflecting their own cultural fantasies as vividly as Oatman's particular experience. It was the subject of a 1965 episode of Death Valley Days, starring Ronald Reagan, an Elmore Leonard story, two novels, and four children's books, including a Christian title sold with a collectible Oatman figurine worth $695, facial tattoo, and all. Since the 1990s, feminist scholars have revisited Oatman, exploring her status as a white captive and her importance as the author of one of the last captivity tales in a literary genre as old as the colonies. In early 2006, on the sesquicentennial of Oatman's rescue, more than 100 people met at Yuma, Arizona, and drove 80 miles into the desert to the site of the Oatman massacre, where the family is buried, to hear Olive's ordeal reprised once again, this time by one of her Mormon descendants. For all its recycling, the only constant about the Oatman story is that no two authors agree on what happened. It's as if the minute she stepped back into the white world and rinsed the mesquite dye from her hair, the truth was washed away and fiction would forever infest her biography. When her family was attacked, for example, Oatman's mother was in labor, or she was carrying a newborn baby who was skewered by the Yavapais. Before her ransom, Oatman was fully absorbed into the Mohave family she had come to love, possibly with a husband and children. Or she was desperate to return to her own people. The day of her delivery from the Mohaves, she tried to bury herself in the sand on the bank of the Colorado River because she didn't want to go home. Or because she was embarrassed to appear topless before her white liberators. She was ecstatic to see her countrymen again. Or she cried hopelessly for 2 days. She married a wealthy banker and lived happily ever after. Or she died, physically wrecked and mentally numbed in an insane asylum. Some Oatman enthusiasts boldly wrote themselves into her life. In 1913, a decade after her death, an 85-year-old bailiff in Omaha boasted in a half-page profile in the Sunday World Herald that he'd single-handedly saved her from the Mojaves by carrying her out of a teepee and delivering her to Fort Whipple in central Arizona. Apparently, no one told him that the Mojaves didn't use teepees, or that Fort Whipple hadn't been built at the time of her ransom. 5 years later, in the Oakland Tribune, a California farmer made the same claim, but his tall tale ran away with him. He said he had been a scout with Kit Carson and Buffalo Bill, battled Sitting Bull, saw Custer take his last breath, and, like Oatman, had been taken captive as a child by Indians who tattooed his chin, conveniently hidden by a full beard at press time. He claimed not only to have rescued the prisoner, but also to have canoed 300 miles through the rapids of the Grand Canyon, a route that no white man ever traversed before, to get her back to civilization. Why has Oatman commanded so much attention? Unlike more prominent women of the 1850s and 1860s, such as Susan B. Anthony, Sojourner Truth, and Harriet Beecher Stowe, she wasn't a social activist, though her public speaking career pushed the limits of feminine convention. She was no feminist, at least not after her ransom. She had lived with a tribe in which women enjoyed a greater degree of physical, sexual, and domestic freedom than white women in America, as well as higher social status in regard to men, even by Native American standards. But in her lectures, she encouraged women to enjoy their homes and be glad they didn't live as she had. She was not a defector, like some famous captives who chose to stay with their tribes, such as Mary Jemison, taken by Shawnee Indians a century earlier and traded to the Seneca at about the same age as Oatman, or Cynthia Ann Parker, who lived with a Comanche from the age of 9 until she was forcibly and tragically returned at age 34 in 1860. Oatman's mysterious persona accounts for a small piece of her star power. She had a gothic beauty. The dozen or so surviving photos of her betray a brooding intensity that reads as a reflection of either her lonely trial or her cleaved self. In all the documentation of her life, articles, interviews, reminiscence by friends, and even her biography, she laughs just once, in an interview conducted on the day of her repatriation, and even then, the source of her amusement is unclear. The Mojaves were terrific mimics who loved a good tease and a bawdy joke. Almost every description of them before their reservation days mentions their laughter, and they were considered notoriously outspoken and uninhibited. The unanswerable question of whether Oatman ever relaxed into their utterly un-Mormon social style only compounds her mystery. The greater part of her fascination, however, lies in her unresolved duality. No American immigrants or captives have worn their hybrid identities so publicly. Like the nation's most famous fictional branded woman, Hester Prynne, who also seized the public imagination in the 1850s, Oatman wore a permanent symbol of soul-searing transgression. She was, in the parlance of her day, redeemed as a captive, but there's little redemption in her story. She was a half-finished woman who neither fully renounced the Mohaves nor settled back comfortably into white culture, which may explain why she contradicted herself. Her affection for her Mohave family, for example, bleeds through the pages of her biography, which includes long stretches of first-person narrative, even as she disparages them, following Stratton's virulently racist agenda. The Blue Tattoo attempts not only to sift out the truth of the Oatman story, but also to offer a historical understanding of it, particularly concerning the Mohaves, a once charismatic and idiosyncratic tribe, the largest in California, now vastly diminished and all but purged from national memory. In the mid-19th century, they too were hybrids of a sort, blending Southwest and Californian Indian traditions, such as face painting and tattoo, respectively, and straddling California and Arizona geographically, on either side of the Colorado River. An accidental ethnographer, Oatman recorded her memories of them in their last decade of sovereignty. Soon after she left them, they were forced off their land and pressed into a life of poverty. Today, only about 1,000 survive. Oatman stood at the crossroads of history when the West was stolen. At the end of the Mexican-American War, with the 1848 Treaty of Guadalupe Hidalgo, half of Mexico was swallowed up by the United States, expanding the nation's girth by 66% and pushing its western boundary from Texas to California. Manifest destiny, a phrase minted in 1845 by the New York Morning News and circulated by an aggressively expansionist president, James K. Polk from Tennessee, encouraged citizens to stampede toward the Pacific and claim what they believed and were told was theirs. For Northerners, this was an opportunity to open the West for democracy. For Southerners, to secure it for slavery. For California Indians who were in the way, it meant genocide. Between 1848 and 1865, an estimated 15,000 out of 72,000 Indians were killed in the Golden State. The bloodshed was no accident. A war of extermination will continue to be waged between the races, California's first governor told the legislature in 1851, till the Indian race becomes extinct. The land grab that made this extermination possible happened under Oatman's feet in the space of a decade. She was living with the Mohaves during the signing of the 1853 Gadsden Purchase, by which Lower Arizona, formerly part of the Mexican state of Sonora, was ceded to the United States. With a corner of New Mexico as the last puzzle piece in the map of the Southwest, Americans were now traversing 1 million square miles of newly acquired land, blind to the borders, cultural, geographical, and psychological, that had previously set them apart from Mexicans and Southwest Indians. Oatman's story reflects the crossed boundaries and trampled frontiers that marked this transaction. She survived the botched pursuit of the American dream, arrived at a geographical and utopian terminus, California, where, as Joan Didion famously put it, we run out of continent. Then reborn as a white Mojave, she turned around and went east again. Her blue tattoo became a poignant, permanent ethnic marker, invoking both the cultural imprint of her Mojave past and the lingering scars of westward expansion. The challenge of separating fact from fiction in retelling the Oatman saga has not been easy. Debunking the rumors that swirled around her in life and death is a fairly simple matter of fact-checking, distinguishing between what she truly experienced in captivity and how Stratton presented it in Captivity of the Oatman Girls, the biography he ghostwrote for her, is more challenging. But by analyzing Stratton's motivations and telling her story, his knowledge of and attitude toward Indians, and his theological and colonial vision of the West, and by examining the passages in Captivity of the Oatman Girls that are provably false, a clear pattern of manipulation emerges, and it is possible to disentangle, to a degree, his story from hers. Chapter 1 reconstructs Oatman's journey west, drawing from Stratton, who had little reason to distort this portion of the narrative beyond excising its references to Mormonism, historical documents, newspapers, and the letters and diaries of people who traveled with the family. chapters 2 through 10, chronicling Oatman's time among the Yavapais and the Mohaves, rely on only the parts of captivity of the Oatman girls that accord with ethnography, military, and historical records, newspaper interviews she gave immediately after her ransom, before she met Stratton, and the memories of Musk Mellon, a Mohave who knew her. Details that cannot be cross-referenced, such as Oatman's relationship with her Mohave family and her brother Lorenzo's post-massacre travels alone in the desert, Chapter 5, are included only if they contain no historical or ethnographic inconsistencies and if they fall outside Stratton's schema of distortion. Some of Lorenzo's story can be checked against accounts he gave decades later. Chapters 11 and 12 identify Stratton's modifications to the story, his motivations for changing it, and the ethnographic errors that flag his meddling. Chapters 13 and 14, chronicling Oatman's adult life in New York and later in Texas, are based on correspondence by, with, and about her, and on newspaper stories about her. Finally, Stratton's book appeared in three editions, published by three different publishers from 1857 to 1858, each longer than the last. In a 1909 edition of the Oregon Teacher's Monthly, which was reprinted by Dover Publications in 1994, and in a 1983 edition published by the University of Nebraska Press. For concision, my citations refer to the latter comprehensive edition by the University of Nebraska Press, except where I have specifically identified an earlier edition. 1. Quicksand. It was starvation to stay, and almost inevitable disaster to go forward. J. Ross Brown, A Tour Through Arizona. The Oatman family spent their last night together, marooned on a tiny island surrounded by quicksand in the Gila River in Mexico. California-bound, they had left their farm in Illinois in May of 1850, joined 20 other families in Missouri in July, and by February of 1851, they were alone. Seven children and their parents, Royce and Mary Ann, in what would become southwestern Arizona, trying to cross the swollen Gila in 3-foot water and failing miserably as their cattle foundered on the river floor. An island little bigger than a sandbar would have to do for the night. Royce unhitched the oxen, led them to the land, then waded across the river to gather firewood. With the help of her older children, Mary Ann unloaded supplies and prepared a dinner of bean soup and stale bread, which the family ate by moonlight. Their situation was desperate. Their horse had died, and their scant remaining cattle were so weak that some of the children, aged 2 to 17, had been forced to walk long stretches of their route from Maricopa Wells, 80 miles back. They were on a barely blazed trail, eroded by recent storms. The food they'd packed under the floor of their prairie schooners before starting west was nearly spent, enough jerked meat and dried fruit, flour, meal, bacon, and beans to last 18 months, or so they thought. They had abandoned one of their wagons in New Mexico after their oxen had dwindled to the point where they had no way to pull it. They had no money, nothing to trade, and over 100 miles to go across the scorched desert before they would reach Fort Yuma, an army post just over the brand new California border. Soon they would have another mouth to feed. Mary Ann was nearly 9 months pregnant. Still, the Oatmans feared one thing more than famine: Indians. Before leaving Maricopa Wells, they had been warned that the Apaches were attacking emigrants up and down the Gila, and their fellow pioneers had urged them to stay. But a famine there made prospects for survival slim. So when a traveling entomologist named John LeConte arrived from Fort Yuma, loaded with fossils and beetle specimens, saying he had seen no trace of Indians on the trail, Royce decided to move on, leaving the remaining two families in his party behind, shaking their heads. 7 days after the Oatmans left Maricopa Wells, LeConte overtook them on his return to Fort Yuma. By now, Royce recognized that his supplies and cattle couldn't possibly carry the family through to Yuma. He wrote a letter to the commander of the fort asking for help, and LeConte promised to deliver it. "I am under the necessity of calling upon you for assistance," he pleaded, requesting horses and harnesses. "There is my wife and seven children, and without help, sir, I am confident we must perish." The next day, 30 miles down the trail, LeConte and his Mexican guide met a band of Indians, four of whom distracted the two men at their camp by feigning friendship and making small talk, while others stole their horses from a nearby valley. Concerned that the Oatman rescue would be delayed for days while he walked the remaining 100 miles to Fort Yuma, LeCount posted a card on a tree, warning the family about the Indians. Though he didn't mention LeCount's card to the children, Royce had previously seen it by the time they reached Aguila, where he began to fray. At the start of the trip, he believed that, treated well, Indians were inherently friendly, and he even blamed their violence on cruel treatment by whites. When he'd worked as a traveling merchant in Iowa, Royce had mastered an attitude of unflappable cool to placate them, and his approach had always worked. But this journey had tested his theory. Some Indians had shared his tobacco and traded with him. Others had stolen his cattle, or pressured him into bartering irreplaceable pots and pans along with beans and bread. One night, as he and his fellow emigrants camped on the Arkansas River, Apaches on the other side had massacred a group traveling in a government expedition and stolen 100 mules. Now the information he'd chosen to ignore back in Maricopa Wells was roiling in his mind. Though LeCount hadn't been assaulted by Indians himself, he had said Apaches were moving in the hills, and Royce knew they were much more likely to menace a family traveling alone than members of a wagon train. That night, a high wind swept river water onto the 200-square-foot island, threatening to snuff out the fire and forcing the family to move its camp repeatedly. No one, including the spooked cattle, got much sleep. 15-year-old Lorenzo spent much of the night tending to the frightened animals, while the older children shivered around the fire, and their parents conferred inside the wagon. Marianne, who had her own worries, not the least of which was kicking inside her, comforted Royce as he broke down and wept for a solid hour, lamenting the dangerous situation he had brought his family into. She assured him he was simply exhausted and his mind was working overtime. Only 17-year-old Lucy, the eldest, heard her father cry. The gravity of the situation hadn't fully impressed Olive and her younger siblings, Royce Jr., 11, Marianne, 7, and Charity Ann, 5, who blithely fantasized about what they would do if Apaches attacked them. One would run, another would fight and die fighting, another would hold them off with a gun or a club. "Well, there is one thing," said 14-year-old Olive, a dark-haired beauty with deep-set eyes and a serious brow. "I shall not be taken by these miserable brutes. I will fight as long as I can, and if I see that I am about to be taken, I will kill myself." Shortly after dawn, the family reloaded their wagon, hitched the cattle again, forded the river, and stopped to let their team graze. At noon, they continued, but the trail led to a lime rock mesa where the beleaguered oxen balked at the steep ascent. The Oatmans unpacked the wagon and began hand-carrying their belongings up the 200-foot-tall bluff. That day, Lucy confided in Lorenzo, describing Royce's tears the night before, and together they noted a change in their 41-year-old father. 5 feet tall, solidly built and bearded, Royce was a man who exuded confidence and readily expressed his feelings. Restless and drawn to novelty, he jumped into new situations with conviction and, some said, arrogance. Until now, despite everything, he had seemed optimistic. But as he mounted the hill, he looked like a defeated man. Royce sat on a rock, turned to his wife, and said, "Mother, in the name of God, I know something terrible is about to happen." After hauling the first load of supplies, the Oatmen stopped for lunch, sitting atop black lava rocks and looking out at the mountains looming north and east of the Gila River. It was a lunar landscape, a parched expanse stippled with patches of dried grass and studded with saguaro cacti, some as many as 200 years old, standing alone and in clusters, like alien sentries lifting their spiky arms to the sun. Red plumes of flowering ocotillo shot up from gangly stalks, and golden brittlebrush bloomed in low clusters across the desert floor. The region was populated by a network of Indians, including friendly Pimas, Maricopas, and Tohono O'odhams, then called Papagos. The Yavapais, hunter-gatherers with links to the Apaches, roamed to the north, carrying bows, arrows, and clubs. 2 years later, this stretch of northern Mexico would be absorbed into the territory of New Mexico, with the signing of the 1853 Gadsden Purchase, mainly because it contained the only navigable southern route to California. running just south of the Gila. Called Cook's Wagon Road, it was the road the Oatmans now traveled. Once the second load had been carried up, Royce started back down the slope, and the family helped the bony cattle pull the empty wagon to the top to be repacked. It was late afternoon. They had advanced just a few miles since dawn and planned to continue in cooler weather at dusk to ease the trip for the animals. By now, the Oatmans had spent hours getting their provisions up the hill and reloaded. The sun was hot, and there was no sound, save for the lowing of the disgruntled livestock. "Thank God we are on our road safe," Marianne said to her husband. "There is no appearance of danger." Lorenzo studied his father, who glumly repacked the wagon. When the boy turned and glanced back down the hill, he saw movement. A procession of Indians, their wolf-skin skirts gently flapping against their thighs, meandering up the incline from the west. They were Yavapais, possibly the same group that had bamboozled LeConte and his guide a day or two before. When Lorenzo turned to his father and pointed, he found Royce's reaction as alarming as he did the arrival of the Indians themselves. His face reddened, then went pale, and Lorenzo saw from his father's twitching mouth that he could barely control his panic. The other family members turned to look. Olive counted 19 Indians. Royce finally found his voice. "Do not be alarmed," he said. "The Indians won't harm you." It was the last thing he would say to his family. As they poured into the camp, Royce addressed the Yavapais in broken Spanish, the lingua franca of the Southwest, inviting them to sit down. They asked for tobacco. He lit a pipe and shared it with them. The Yavapais glared nervously around the mesa as they smoked, exchanging knowing glances even as they claimed they had come in peace. When they requested food, Royce resisted, explaining that if he fed them, his family would starve. Still, they insisted. He gave them bread, and they demanded more, standing up and rummaging around inside the wagon themselves. When Royce again refused, they stepped aside and formed a circle, conferring in their own language. Lorenzo stood near the Indians as they spoke, while his father reorganized the wagon, keeping an eye on the intruders and struggling to conceal his terror. Royce had always believed that if you didn't show fear around Indians, they wouldn't attack, but he was now far from feigning self-possession. Marianne climbed inside the wagon, taking 3-year-old Roland with her. Lucy and Olive stood to one side near the 3 younger children. Little Marianne sat on a nearby rock, holding the rope to the cattle teams between her knees, waiting. They were ready to go. It took mere minutes for the Yavapais to bludgeon most of the family to death. Pulling knives and war clubs from their skirts, they jumped, shrieking, and assaulted Royce first, then clubbed Lorenzo on the back of the head until he fell face down in the dirt, bleeding from his ears. They pushed Olive aside to get to her mother, the baby, and Charity Ann. 11-year-old Royce Jr. stood mute with shock until a single blow took him writhing to the ground. Untouched, Marianne crumpled, crying into her hands the rope at her feet on the other side of the wagon. Olive took in the spectacle and fainted. "When I recovered my thoughts," she later wrote, "I could hardly realize where I was, and I thought I was probably dying. I knew that all, or probably all, the family had been murdered. Thus bewildered, confused, half conscious and half insensible, I remained a short time. I know not how long. Occasionally a low, piteous moan would come from someone of the family as in a dying state. I distinguished the groans of my poor mother and sprang wildly toward her, but was held back by the merciless savage holding me in his cruel grasp and lifting a club over my head, threatening me in the most taunting, barbarous manner." It was an empty gesture. She and Marianne would be spared. For the next hour, Olive and Marianne watched as their attackers ransacked the wagon and looted the bodies of the dead and dying. Lorenzo stirred as they yanked off his hat and shoes, so the Yavapais dragged him by the feet to the edge of the mesa and threw him off. Olive turned away to avoid seeing his head dashed against the rocks. They ripped the cover off the wagon, removed parts of the wheels, unhitched the teams, broke open boxes, and packed up what food they could carry, including 2 sacks of smoked beef Royce hadn't offered them. Marveling at the odd domestic conveniences they found in the white man's wagon, they pulled out a duvet and tore it open, releasing the down to the wind. Olive watched the feathers float to the ground and blow along the dusty mesa, sticking to the carnage of the family she would leave behind. With a shove, Olive and Marianne were driven down the hill barefoot to begin a journey of about 60 miles over 4 days. As she stumbled forward, searing her feet in the sand and sweating clear through the bodice of her dress, Olive wished the Yavapais would kill her too. But there was Marianne, crying, drooling, and tripping along behind her. Olive's life as a frontier woman had begun. 2. Indian Country. The Gila River area is so utterly desolate, desert, and godforsaken that Kit Carson says a wolf could not make his living upon it. U.S. Representative Thomas Hart Benton, addressing the House of Representatives, June 26, 1854. Forced to discard their shoes to avoid leaving a recognizable trail, the Oatman girls found themselves being marched barefoot at warrior speed back across the river and through a dark ravine to an Indian camp in the hills. They traveled in two groups, one leading the captives, the other the animals. At the camp, the Indians slaughtered a cow and cooked the meat over a fire made with flint and wild cotton. Then they baked dough made from the oatman's flour and soaked it in bean soup. They scornfully offered the food to the girls, perhaps mocking Royce's claim that he had had no food. But they couldn't eat. They watched in silence, their stomachs rumbling, as their captors ate under the full moon to the sound of coyotes crying in the hills. Olive's worst fear was that she and her sister would be burned alive. Marianne was more concerned about leaving her dead family behind. After the meal, Olive and Marianne huddled together by the campfire, terrified, as the Yavapais jeered at them, especially Marianne. When her feelings became uncontrollable, Olive recalled, she would hide her head in my arms and most piteously sob aloud, but she was immediately hushed by the brandishing of a war club over her head. The Yavapais periodically pointed at the mesa in the distance, where Olive could still see the exposed boughs of the oatman wagon stripped of its covering. Mangled as I knew they were, she said, I longed to go back and take one look, one long, last farewell look in the faces of my parents. She remembered the impossibly trusting expressions of the little ones, Charity Ann and Roland, when Royce Sr. had told them not to fear the Indians, and she recalled how Royce Jr. had convulsed as he died. Wary of being discovered by whites near the site of the massacre, the Yavapais pushed on an hour later. Tears stung Olive's eyes when she looked back to see that the ravaged wagon, the last vestige of her former life, had disappeared into the mountains behind her. They traveled for several hours, too fast for the girls, whose feet were now bleeding. If the oatmen slowed down, the Yavapais threatened them with their clubs. When Marianne gave up, collapsing in a heap, she was beaten and told she would be left behind. She asked Olive to let them kill her. I resolved, said Olive, in the event of her being left, to cling to her and thus compel them to dispose of us as they had the remainder of the family. She begged them not to leave her sister, and as she pleaded her case, one Indian removed his pack, handed it to another, threw Marianne on his back, and continued on. Scrambling to keep pace, Olive watched Marianne surrender to exhaustion. I managed to look into her face and found her eyes opening and shutting alternately, as if in an effort to wake, but still unable to sleep. I spoke to her, but received no answer. We could not converse without exciting the fiendish rage of our enemies. The Yavapais were worried about making time and seemed fearful. Heading northeast, they raced over a series of small bluffs and into a winding valley, making a single brief stop in the middle of the night, then walking until noon the next day. Along the way, Marianne quietly slipped into shock. Olive looked into her eyes to see if she was conscious and saw that her sister had become utterly indifferent to all about her, and, wrapped in a dreamy reverie, relieved of all care of life or death, presenting the appearance of one who had simply the consciousness that some strange, unaccountable event had happened, and in its bewildering effects, she was content to remain. They rested for 2 hours at a camp in an open space surrounded by mountains. The Yavapais killed the rest of the oatmen's animals and sliced them up, broiled another meal of meat, bread, and bean soup, and packed the rest to be carried on their backs. Overcome by hunger, the girls now ate the stringy beef. Again, Marianne was told to walk, refused, and was beaten, then carried. The Yavapais tied leather to Olive's bleeding feet to protect them, and that night they stopped camp in a clearing in the woods. The girls slept in the sand, guarded by Indians. Breakfast was, as Olive put it, beef, burn dough, and beans. Instead of beans, burn dough, and beef as usual. They resumed their journey on hillier roads that Olive later deemed the roughest she ever traveled as a captive. That day is among the few days of my dreary stay among the savages, marked by the most pain and suffering ever endured. By now her death wish was overriding her impulse to protect Marianne. Twice she gave up, begging to be killed and left behind, but instead was pushed and dragged along. Around noon, the party met nearly a dozen Comanches, a tribe notorious not only for its ferocity, but also for its sadistic torture methods. One of the Comanches took one look at Olive, strung his bow and shot at her, piercing only the ragged skirt of her dress. He was in the act of hurling the second, she later recalled, when two of our number sprang toward them with their clubs, while two others snatched us to one side, placing themselves between us and the drawn bows. Olive later learned the man had lost his brother to whites on the Santa Fe Trail and had vowed to kill the next white person he saw. The two tribes nearly came to blows. One group of Yavapais stayed behind to wrangle with the Comanches, while another hurried the girls along. Marianne confided to Olive, "I wish they had killed us." On the fourth day, they arrived at the home of the Yavapais, near modern-day Congress, Arizona. "With all they had endured," said Olive, "to get even into an Indian camp was home." Surrounded by hills, the camp consisted of low thatched huts sunk into the ground. All 300 inhabitants were called out to inspect the white prisoners. One man made a speech, then unpacked the spoils of the Oatman raid and proudly exhibited them. The warriors who'd captured Olive and Marianne were hailed as heroes, and a ritual of ridicule began. The sisters were forced to stand on a pile of twigs and branches while the Yavapais, male and female, young and old, wearing blankets, bark, skins, or nothing, gathered around them. "Music then commenced," wrote Olive, "which consisted of pounding upon stones with clubs and horn, and the drawing of a small string, like a fiddle bow, across distended bark. Circling the girls, the tribe yelled, spat, and threw dirt at them. Some Yavapais reached out and slapped them as they revolved around them. It seemed that their main ambition was to exhibit their superiority over us and the low, earnest, intense hate they bore toward our race," said Olive. The Yavapai children especially elicited great guffaws from their elders by taunting the girls, who clasped each other in fear, terrified that their worst was yet to come. If the tribe had kidnapped them to torture them to death, they wouldn't have been the first to meet this fate. But this wasn't the Yavapai's intention. The abuse the Oatmans now endured set the tone for their relationship with their captors over the next year. They were slaves. "Now, when you remember our ages," wrote Olive, "our journey of 4 days and 4 nights, the scene of slaughter witnessed, our fears and the attack of the Comanches, our bleeding, aching limbs, and this introduction of two young girls to Indian life, and then you get something of an idea of our situation and the providence that sustained us." 3. How little we thought what was before us. "Oh, the good time has come at last. We need no more complain, sir. The rich can live in luxury, and the poor can do the same, sir. For the good time has come at last, and as we all are told, sir, we shall be rich at once now. With California gold, sir." Campfire Song, 1840s. If a belief in Providence sustained Olive and Marianne in captivity, it was also what had propelled them into the hands of the Yavapais in the first place. The Oatmans were Mormons, who had joined a wagon train headed to the mouth of the Colorado River to settle in the land of Bashan, which they believed would be a Mormon paradise. They were Brewsterites, a splinter sect started in 1837 after 11-year-old James Colin Brewster claimed to have had divine revelations that Mormon founder Joseph Smith deemed phony. With the help of his father, Brewster published his translation of the writings of Esdras, a figure he alleged was an ancient Hebrew prophet who had predicted the world's end in 1878, as well as the reorganization of the church under the boy, Revelator, himself. Smith was unimpressed by the vision and irked by the boy's challenge to his authority. Mormon doctrine stipulated that only Smith could channel God, and Brewster's strong objection to polygamy didn't endear him to Smith, who had dozens of wives. The church condemned Brewster in its newspaper, Times and Seasons, declaring in 1842,
"We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description."